All right, guys, how's it going? Intel has launched the latest in their Core i7 Extreme Edition range, codenamed Broadwell-E. Now, this is Intel's HEDT series, their high-end desktop, and comprises of their most powerful desktop processors. What's probably the big news here is that this is Intel's first 10-core processor for the desktop. But before we take a closer look at the features and architecture of the new CPU, we'll take a quick look at how we got here. Intel's CPU evolution follows a pattern known as tick-tock, and this is actually pretty simple. Whenever Intel moves on to the next node, that is the nanometer node, for example, in the case of Ivy Bridge, Intel moved on to 22 nanometers, this is known as a tick. So this was the third generation of their core series of CPUs. Following on from Ivy Bridge came Haswell, still on 22 nanometers, and this is known as the new microarchitecture, what Intel calls their TOC. Following on a year, we get to the fifth generation Broadwell, which was on 14 nanometers and again a tick. So this is the pattern that Intel CPUs have followed for many years now. An update to the architecture followed by an update to the nanometer process. Generally speaking, you can be looking at 10% improvement in each case. The smaller nanometer sizes allow for faster clock speeds and lower power, whereas improvements in the architecture allow for higher IPC, or instructions per clock. Now, most of you will be aware that Skylake is the latest architecture, not Broadwell, yet Intel has just launched Broadwell-E. The reason for this is simply the way in which they release CPUs these days. They start off with a smaller, more mainstream and performance range on a new architecture, before following up with the higher-end desktop on the previous architecture. So the performance in mainstream is now Skylake, and the high-end desktop is Broadwell. In around about a year's time, the high-end desktop will have evolved onto Skylake. There are one or two good reasons for doing this. The first one is, of course, economics. When you move on to a new process node, that is a tick, the economics of the new node are not that good early on. The wafers in which the chips are built have defects, which means early on in the process you get less good chips on a wafer. And the best way to mitigate this is by using smaller chips. Over the following months, the process continues to improve, and the yields improve to the point where larger chips become much more viable, and this is what these Extreme Edition chips are. They have a lot more cores, and they are generally much larger CPUs. Another good reason for doing it this way is that it's insurance against an issue with the new architecture. For example, if Skylake had some kind of bug or error, Intel will still be falling back on Broadwell-E when it comes to the high-end desktop. There are other reasons. For example, a lack of competition because AMD CPUs are nowhere means that Intel can basically do whatever they want due to having no real CPU competition. Now, moving on to Broadwell itself, on initial release in the performance and mainstream markets, Broadwell was not that well received. Compared to the previous generation i7s and i5s, it was a pretty peculiar CPU. We can see from this chart that even though it was on the new 14 nanometer process, which normally means higher clock speeds, in this case there was a regression in both the CPU base frequency and the maximum turbo frequency compared to the previous generation 4770K, which had a CPU base of 3.5 and a max turbo of 3.9. Looking at the TDP numbers shows why, with the 5775C having a TDP of only 65 watts compared to 84 watts of the Haswell 4770K. The reason for this is that around this time, Intel had started to double down on power, because simply put, performance per watt is much more important these days. But the more that the process was tweaked towards lower power, the more difficult the higher clock speeds become. It did have slightly higher IPC over Haswell as well, which in most cases meant that Broadwell was slightly faster, or at least equal to the 4770K, and in many benchmarks it seemed to be a pretty decent gamer as well. So it wasn't a bad CPU by any means, it just wasn't quite what the performance market had been used to, and it didn't help that Haswell CPUs like the 4790K with a base clock of 4GHz had launched earlier. So Broadwell really didn't set the earth on fire. Will Broadwell-E be any different? Well, let's take a closer look at it. Now, I'm just going to take a look at the specs comparing the incoming Broadwell-E CPUs to the comparative outgoing Haswell-E CPU. The top-end Haswell-E i7-5960X is being replaced by the i7-6900K. Both CPUs have 8 cores and 16 threads due to hyperthreading, but straight away we can see that the new Broadwell-E i7-6900K has 0.2GHz higher base clock and turbo clock compared to the outgoing 5960X. 20MB of cache is of course the same. The new Broadwells have memory support for up to 2400MHz DDR4. TDP remains the same at 140W, and we're looking at a 9% increase in price from $999 up to $1,089. We kind of expected to see a small increase in price there, but it is good to see that Broadwell-E's clock speeds are higher than Haswell-E's, given what we already saw with the 5775C. Now, if we move on to the middle ones, we're looking at the i7-5930K from Haswell-E and the new Broadwell-E i7-6850K. We have a core count of 6 and 12 threads. In this case though, the Broadwell-E only has 0.1 GHz higher base and turbo clock, and again the cache is the same at 15 MB, with the same story on memory and TDP. In this instance, there is a 6% increase in price from $583 up to $617. And finally, as far as the comparisons goes, we have the very popular Haswell-E i7-5820K up against the new Broadwell-E i7-6800K. Once again, we have 6 cores, 12 threads. However, this time, the Broadwell-E only has 0.1 GHz higher base clock. The turbo clock remains the same at 3.6 GHz. The cache is identical at 15 MB. And once again, the memory and TDP are the same as before. In this instance though, the price has increased by 12%, which is the highest increase of all. Are you getting your money's worth there? Really what this comes down to is, how well do both of these CPUs overclock? But like I said, the big thing about this release is Intel's introduction of their new 10-core, 20-thread i7-6950X processor. Finally got 10 cores on the desktop, and as you can see here, the base clock of 3 GHz and the turbo boost frequency of up to 3.5 GHz is the same as the previous generation Haswell-E 5960X. So the switch to 14 nanometers has allowed Intel to add 2 more cores yet keep the same frequencies. That's pretty impressive when you think about it. You've also got another 5 MB of cache, all at the same 140 watts TDP. Now, I must admit to having a bit of a chuckle at this. Quite a few people actually believed that the 6950X would simply replace the 8-core 5960X. Like, that would be the drop-in replacement, basically speaking, 2 extra cores for the same money. But that was never on the cards. And as you can see, at $1,723, that is quite a bit more to pay for those extra 2 cores. But again, without the competition, they can really charge whatever they like. Now, before we move on to the features of the new CPU, we'll have a look at the die shot that Intel has provided. You can see all 10 cores here, down either side, 5 on each side. In the middle is all the 25 MB of L3 cache. Down the bottom, you've got the memory controller, and up the top, we have the Uncore, which for Intel is a logic that is not included in the cores, but is essential for their operation. And you've got all your I/O stuff up here as well. It has a die size of 251 millimeters squared, which is more than twice the size of the 122.4 millimeters squared of Skylake. 251 millimeters squared, however, is a good size for a CPU of this massive performance level. And as usual, all of the cut down parts, for example, your 6850K, your 6800K, it's all based on the same die, simply with some cores and some cache fused off. So what would you do with the first 10 core processor for the desktop? Well, Intel is pitching it as a CPU for gaming, VR, content creation and overclocking. I'm not entirely convinced that a 10-core processor is really suitable for gaming, or overclocking for that matter, but we shall see. For me, a 10-core CPU is all about content creation. This is the sort of CPU that a guy like me would love, because obviously a lot of my day is spent editing, encoding, rendering videos, and this is where more cores really matters. More creating, less waiting. That one's actually pretty good, because I feel like this a lot, especially when I was doing the gaming videos, where a 30-minute video would take over an hour for rendering in preparation for YouTube. So really, this is what the i7-6950X is all about for me. Video editing, video transcoding, video creation. If you're involved in something like this on a daily basis, then these extra 2 cores could be a real godsend. And that's why it costs over $1,700, because time is money, and getting these jobs done faster will pay for the CPU and more in the long run. Now, moving on to gaming, Intel always likes to use the 3D Mark physics score. It's utterly meaningless though, because you don't see anything like this during gaming. Well, that used to be the case. However, I've talked about this in the past, where more cores could become much more useful in future. You've got a game like Ashes of the Singularity, which is a game I have talked about a lot as the first true DX12 title, which is known to scale very well with more CPU cores. And here we can see 45% more FPS versus 4 cores. So in this instance, your 6950X, 45% faster than the i7-6700K. This may well be a portent of things to come, but in my opinion, we're still quite a few years away from that yet. and over the piece, the 6700K will be a better gaming CPU than the 6950X. A good midway point may be the 5820K and now the new incoming 6800K. Now obviously if megatasking is your thing, then you can megatask even more with 10 cores, but you probably figured that one out before now. Perhaps the most interesting new feature is Intel Turbo Boost 3.0. We have the normal Turbo Boost, which increases performance depending on how heavy the workload is on the CPU, and we know that in the case of the 6950X, the maximum turbo speed is 3.5 GHz. However, with the new Intel Turbo Boost 3 technology, the single-threaded performance, that is one core, can be boosted even higher. So this is a good thing for very single-threaded applications. It's actually rather clever, and what Intel has done is measured the performance of each of the 10 cores. As you can see here on the right, core 9 would be the best core, all the way down to core 0 being the worst. Perhaps a lot of people don't realise this, but individual cores do actually perform differently on every CPU. The difference probably isn't that much, but in terms of performance and in terms of performance per watt, there can be slight differences. So obviously, if something was running in a single thread, you would want it running on the best CPU core, right? This is what Intel Turbo Boost Max Technology 3.0 attempts to do. Now it actually requires a driver. Sadly I can't show you it working because I don't have a Broadwell-E CPU. But once you install the driver, the program runs in the background and anything that has a strong single thread should see a pretty decent benefit. We don't know exactly how far though, as Intel really can't guarantee how fast the single fastest core will be. So they were kind of evasive on that one. It does need to be set in the BIOS, and the top speed will be up to the motherboard manufacturer. So for example, something like the 6950X may have a top speed of 4 GHz single core, or it could be as low as 3.8, depending on the motherboard, depending on the CPU. It is basically a bit like overclocking again. Considering that you do need to go into the BIOS to set it up, and that there's a bit of pot luck there, it is a little bit like overclocking all over again. But it's very interesting to see, and you can sort of see how this should evolve in future, where the CPU may dynamically change core. For example, if one core has been running single-threaded for a while, it will start to heat up, which is what you don't want. So then it could maybe switch to a cooler core, second on the list, before switching back to the first one after the first one has cooled down. These are just natural evolutions of chip architecture, and it's something we might even see in Skylake E. But that's a very interesting little feature and something that could certainly help in certain workloads, because these big 10-core CPUs do have a bit of an Achilles heel when it comes to single-thread performance. And I'm now going to wrap up this video by finally taking a look at performance. Now over at Anantech, there is once again a fantastic review of the CPUs, so I will leave a link in the description for that, be sure to check it out. But for now, I shall look at one or two of their benchmarks. Cinebench R15 single-threaded performance. To nobody's surprise, the i7-6700K is still up top. This is a combination of IPC and clock speeds. The two CPUs with the fastest clock speeds are up the top. In this instance though, over at Anantech, they turned off the single core turbo because it's a very difficult thing to review. It's a little bit of a shame, it would have been nice to see it in action. But otherwise, what you're looking at here is what you'd expect to see. Higher single threaded performance, higher on the chart. And if we look at say the 6800K, it is 7% higher than the 5820K. And we know that they have the same clock speeds. So what this shows is that Broadwell-E does indeed have around about a 5 to 7% IPC advantage over the outgoing Haswell-E CPU. It's a similar story with the 6850K versus the 5930K and the 6900K ahead of the 4960X. So no unpleasant surprises there, at least. And we basically get the opposite story in Cinebench R15, multi-threaded. Probably expect a 10-core CPU to take the lead here. And that's exactly what it does. It is then followed by the 8-core 6900K, with the final two Broadwell-E CPUs a little bit behind the 5960X. Interesting to see the 6800K a little bit ahead of the 5930K, which again is related to IPC advancements. This is what high-end gaming looks like. There is effectively no difference between any of these CPUs, unless you're running SLI or in some very specific CPU bound titles, in which case you would expect to see the 6700K win by a little. That is Grand Theft Auto 5 on a GTX 980. And looking at Shadow of Mordor, the result is the same. There is very little difference between any quad core and above CPU of the past 5 years, in fact. For me, if you're a gamer, you still have two choices for Intel. You're going to be looking at the new incoming 6800K or the current 6700K. Or whether or not you think 4 cores is enough, or if you want the 6 cores of the high-end Broadwell-E desktop. Like we saw in Ashes of the Singularity, we may see more games starting to use more cores. Total War Warhammer is yet another game showing benefit of using more cores. So these grand strategy games, with a lot of units on screen, these are games that may make you consider going with perhaps the 6800K or the 6850K. For me though, your 6900X, your 6950X, these are still really for the big content creators out there, and generally speaking represent very poor value for gamers. Hopefully I'll be getting hold of one of these at some point in the future, and I'll get some proper benchmarks done. I will also be updating my PC builds to reflect the new CPUs. And that was Intel's new Broadwell-E high-end desktop family of processors. I still think Intel needs to do a little bit more regarding innovation. This Turbo Boost 3 stuff is great. I want to see more of this from Intel. And maybe with Zen coming at the end of the year, this is exactly what Intel will start doing again. Competition is good for us buyers, not just because of prices, but because of innovation. As far as Zen goes though, you're talking 6 months plus. If you need the performance now, there's only one company can offer it. And the best CPUs for that purpose, quite simply, is Intel's new Broadwell-E series of CPUs. Prices have increased, which is never good to see. Some people gonna be upset at the $1,723 6950X. For me, if you're worried about the price, you probably don't need that CPU anyway, and you're almost certainly better served with the 6800. Right, that's it for this one. So hopefully there will be some interesting chat in the discussion below. As usual, there's a bunch of links in the description as well, and I'll catch you later, guys.